Good afternoon, hello, and good afternoon, everybody. It's a real pleasure for me to actually host all of you for a change to a conference on India that is upbeat. It's been far too long, and too many conferences over the last few years have been reflective of a very volatile, dubious mood about India. And now it's good to revel in the somewhat in the euphoria, with the obvious caution that we should not overdo it. So with, not that I want to temper your expectations, but what I would like to do is to share with you perspectives on what is a very rapidly changing environment in three dimensions. So I will talk briefly about or share with you briefly my take on the politics of what's happening and why I believe what we are seeing is fundamentally different and represents a fundamental departure from the last decade. Not just the last decade, from the last several decades. Okay. So I'll spend a brief few minutes on that. Then I will turn to what's happening and not happening in the infrastructure space. And then finally, because the two are very closely interconnected, I will share some thoughts and views on the banking sector and perhaps also IDFC's own ambitions in the banking space. So first, about the politics. You know, you are all business people and investors, so you have a very different take from armchair analysts and observers of government and policymakers. But for the first few months, there was a lot of criticism, and frankly, it still goes on, of this government that they are not making any decisive changes. First of all, there was a lot of criticism of the budget, remember, that it wasn't really path-breaking. For a government that has this kind of mandate, what the hell are these people doing? Are they wasting our time? Is it just going to be more of the same? So I wanted to suggest to you to look at the performance of this government and set our expectations from this government on the basis of three metrics. So the first one is examine their focus and their priorities, and I'll explain what that means. The second is try to decipher and calibrate what their economic stroke political philosophy is. And then the third one is, and this is very important, is to keep track of their emerging political style. Right? And all three of them will translate into, you know, you can then at least theoretically score how they've done and calibrate how we expect them to do. So on their focus and priorities. Now, as any good manager, CEO knows, when you inherit a burning platform, visioning is only 5% of your priorities. 95% of your effort is actually into changing mindsets and delivering change. So that's how I look at what these people have been trying to do. Their priorities are not big ticket economic reform in a theoretical sense. They are fundamentally pragmatists. They're doers. They're not thinkers as such. It's quite a stark difference from, you know, senior people in the last government. So that's one. Doers, not thinkers, and therefore focus on administration, focus on outcomes, focus on delivery, not immediately preoccupied with, you know, sketching out a grand vision of economic reform in the sense that you and I understand it, right? On this measure, I think they have done remarkably well in a very short period of time. And if you haven't seen it, I urge you to go to the YouTube site and listen to Mr. Modi's speech on Make in India. Right? Again, as a business person or somebody running a business, you will appreciate the impact of that articulation and that speech. My takeaway from that speech was that what Mr. Modi and the government have been trying to do is attack the ease of doing business by tackling the mindset of the bureaucracy. So if you go to Delhi these days, and anybody will notice, the level of activity is much greater. More importantly, the degree of interministerial coordination is much, much deeper. And decisions are being made at a much faster pace than they were before. So there is a distinct impact that these people have already had on the nature and functioning of administration. Now remember again, so one critique that people have of this is that how can one person change everything? It's true, one person cannot change everything in this country. But remember, in this country, the management style that has proven to be effective at scale is actually quite top-down. It's fairly authoritarian, right? So if you think of bosses, I mean, in our own industry, in the banking industry, in the financial services industry, Mr. K.V. Kamath, he was a pretty authoritarian leader and a very, very effective one. Built an organization at real scale. So not that everything depends on one person, but the forcefulness and purposefulness of leadership is very critical to getting the bureaucracy and administration to fall in line. So that's been their first point of attack, and I think that so far they've really done a pretty good job. It's a very, very long journey, but they've done a pretty good job. Now, if I were to expect more, what do I expect from this focus of priorities, this priority of improving administration, in terms of reforms as we understand it? What I expect is for the number of laws to actually be reduced. So there's a whole project now to simplify the legislative footprint out of Parliament. There's a whole task force that is looking at how many laws can we get rid of. There is an escalating war, if you like, on Inspector Raj. And it is a war because this will have to be fought over multiple, multiple years. But it's a good beginning and it's a good attitudinal change. Second criteria for judging the performance of this government is their economic, political philosophy of life. You know, these people, again, compared to the previous government, are not that idealist. And they're not dogmatic is the word I'm looking for, right? They're not ideological and they're not dogmatic. But if you had to sift through and point to one change or one difference between their positioning and the previous government's positioning, it would be the following. This government is unashamedly, unabashedly pro-poor and pro-business. They don't see a trade-off. They don't see a conflict. And they are willing and able to actually carry that argument and narrative. The previous government felt that it was a trade-off. So they ended up, despite technocrats in senior positions, including the Prime Minister himself, they ended up talking about being pro-business, but acting and behaving anti-business and projecting themselves essentially as pro-poor. Now, in political terms, this is a very important shift from left to right, although this is not how it's being articulated. Right? And this is reflected in a number of measures that they have already taken, they're in the process of taking, And I'll give you two examples. One is the land acquisition bill. For the previous government, having passed this over-engineered piece of legislation, it would have been politically impossible for them to simplify it, because it would have been seen as a betrayal of the Aam Aadmi. For this government, that's not the case. They are out there actually making the case, trying to communicate the case, and they're quite confident about it, that simplification of this legislation is extremely important to get business off the ground, to get growth going, and they fully intend to actually revisit that act. So I expect some changes to land legislation in the coming quarters. Second example is what they've been doing on labor laws. Now, at the central government level, it is still in process, but in BJP-controlled states, labor laws have been attacked. So whether it's Rajasthan, now Madhya Pradesh, they are moving in that direction, and it goes towards, it basically is an indicator again of their political self-confidence, that just because they are trying to tweak and modernize labor laws does not make them anti-labor, it does not make them anti-poor. They have the self-confidence to actually articulate that and get these changes pushed through in important legislation. Final metric, as I said, is their political style. Now, what do I mean by that? There are two features of their style that are very different from the previous governments. One is what has been termed cooperative federalism. So because the Prime Minister came from a state government, he empathizes and understands very well the perspective of the states, and therefore is able and much more willing to actually cut deals with state governments. And in any federal system, to get pan-India change, it is very important to actually cut deals with provincial governments, otherwise you can't get anything done. Previous government just did not have that skill set. Maybe didn't have the political mandate, but I don't think they even had the attitude of mind to be able to tackle these issues, right? And what are the indications that they are moving in this direction? So one is the abolition of the Planning Commission, which, you know, may sound like a trivial thing, but it is actually quite important. And what it means is that control over central government funding that is allocated to the states will shift from the Planning Commission to actually the state governments themselves. This is what I mean by cooperative federalism. Rather than over-engineering, over-determining, and prescribing to state governments how they should spend the money that is coming to them from the central government, this government is actively exploring mechanisms that will give the state governments much more freedom to use central government allocations as part of general budgetary contributions at the state level. So that buys them a huge amount of goodwill, and I would be very disappointed actually if over the next 6 months or so we are not able to get a breakthrough on the general services tax. So I'm fully expecting, again coming back to the vocabulary of reforms as you and I understand it, I'm fully expecting a GST to be passed in Parliament, or a deal to be cut on GST in the coming months. The second aspect about their political style is their accent on communication. I mean, Mr. Modi in his trip to Australia made a very important point that he was focused on building consensus around reforms. The previous government was about pursuing or not pursuing reforms by stealth. It was too difficult to get support for the reform agenda, so it was left to the Prime Minister with no political clout to try and do something with his friends in the Finance Ministry. But in the end, This is really the politician's job. It is the elected official's job to carry the people who have elected him or her along the direction of reform. So communication is much more effective, and I expect, therefore, for a lot more changes, for the ground to be prepared for more changes in the coming months and coming years. The last point I'll make on this issue is that is the following. It's a bit. I'll risk it. Let me say it anyway. So see why I started off these comments by saying that actually I see this change in government to mark a very fundamental change that could last a long time. What do I mean by that? The best way I can explain it is in the context of the ease of doing business. I have for the longest time argued that the reforms that we triggered in 1991 were really a technocratic framework of textbook deregulation. But the soft infrastructure of actually moving the economy administratively and attitudinally in the direction of a market-led system, that job was never done. So if you look at our government at any level, right, any level of administration, there is a visceral antipathy towards business. The standard issue bureaucrat in this country does not understand business, right? So until you change that mindset, it's going to be very difficult to get the regulatory infrastructure, the judicial infrastructure to be accommodating of business. And this is an incredible irony for our country, that here we have so much innate entrepreneurial talent, which resides in so many communities, but we have a system and a mindset and government that is anti-business. And that anti-business sentiment and mindset in government comes from years, going back to, you know, colonial history, where the only role of government, the British never felt it was their role to encourage domestic business. It was their role to actually tax land and enforce law and order. So what are the two pillars of our bureaucracy, our IAS, right? There's the collector, the collectorate. What does that mean? He just collects taxes. And there's the magistrate, the district magistrate, who enforces law and order, right? Business, where does that come into anything? They really don't know, they struggle with how to do that, right? And therefore, if you look at the type of people who go into government, there are certain type. And I don't want to sound politically incorrect, but it's sort of amusing, actually. If you go through the list of people who are in the CBI, you know, they'll all be Sinha's Thakur Singhs. There is not a single Agarwal or a Gupta in CBI. On a lighter note. And it's not a coincidence that the CBI does not understand commerce. So for a policeman, everybody's a thief. So what I'm saying all this, this is why this government is very important. Now you look at where Mr. Modi comes from, right? His upbringing, his community, his experience, he understands dhanda. He understands business, right? And this is a cultural change that is now coming from the top, to which our government and bureaucracy over the years is going to have to respond. And if these people maintain momentum, if they don't, and there are risks, there are political risks, the biggest risk is that they get cocky, they get too arrogant in the absence of significant opposition. There are many, many accidents that could happen along the way, right? And I will not go into the cultural aspects of the BJP. They can have a long debate around that. So there is definitely a risk of overreach by this government. But if they stay the course and if they remain disciplined, there's no reason why they cannot be here for quite some time and bring about this very fundamental change from the Nehruvian Brahminical way that this country was run to an economy that is truly market friendly and not anti-poor. Okay, so that's on politics. I've wandered off a little bit, but let me quickly turn to infrastructure. So on infrastructure, the problems are actually very, very deep, as we all know. So let me give you a very quick vignette. And the essence of the problem is that we have tried to navigate from going from public to private participation in infrastructure, and we are in a halfway house. So we are neither here, we're neither there, and therefore we're in a big mess. Right? So what is the background about Indian infrastructure? As you all know, that for political economy reasons, in a country like ours, we have had very little fiscal space to do anything but subsidies and social expenditure, because that's a political priority in a vibrant democracy like ours. No government in this country can be anti-poor. Right? So social spending out of the government budget is an absolute necessity. That leaves, by definition, little fiscal space, even if you're much more disciplined about avoiding waste and raising more revenues, closing tax loopholes. I'm just saying that the political economy of our country is that we will never have enough fiscal space for the government to be funding infrastructure at the scale that we need it. Right? Infrastructure being a quasi-public good, where the price of it has to be regulated. We are forced strategically by our constraints to invite the private sector to deliver infrastructure services. So we started doing that in the mid-1990s. That is how IDFC was created. Our dharma was supposed to be the handmaiden to private investors in infrastructure. And we've grown a lot on that basis. And starting with telecoms, then going on to roads, then going to power generation, ports, airports, etc. There has been absolutely phenomenal growth in private participation in infrastructure in this country. So we've gone from whatever it was, 3.5-4% of GDP equivalent in 2003, almost all of it was public investment at that time, to about 7.5-8% equivalent of spending on infrastructure last year, of which a significant share was actually from the private sector. The last 5 years, so the five-year plan, or whatever the $600-700 billion that was invested during the course of that five-year plan, 37% came from the private sector, in the sense that the equity risk, the construction risk, and the operating risk were taken by private parties. Telecom penetration, you all know all about. Port capacity, how much of it, containerized ports, is now in private hands, you know all about. The point is, in a very short period of time, this country has done wonders in terms of the scale of private participation into infrastructure delivery. That's the glass half full. The glass half empty is that this has been a case of too much too soon. In the most sophisticated of countries, to get a private for-profit operator to deliver a service in a manner that adjudicates and balances the interest of the general consuming public is a very tough thing to do. It requires very sophisticated contract design. It requires very deep regulatory infrastructure, complete autonomy and technical expertise on the part of the regulator. It requires very deep technical expertise on the part of the judiciary, because dispute resolution is a necessary part of any public-private contracting. It requires an administration that understands what business is. We have had none of these things. And therefore, we are in a mess. Take the power sector, and that will encapsulate for you where we are. The electricity supply chain, what is it? in this country. You start with fuel, coal, most of it is coal. It's a state or it's a central government monopoly. That terrifying animal called Coal India is the monopoly that controls all coal mining in the country. Then you have generation, and generation is where we've opened it to the private sector. Do you know that 35% now of total generating capacity of 250,000 megawatts sits in private hands? Or 30%, going to 35%, because another 50,000 of private capacity is actually under construction. Below, further down the supply chain, you have distribution, and distribution is not a central government, but it is a provincial government monopoly. So you have the private generator that is squeezed between two government-owned monopolies. And both these government monopolies have very powerful political compunctions. So the distribution network is driven by the political needs of agricultural consumers, retail consumers, and therefore do not want to raise tariffs. They behave very irresponsibly and continue to do so. So the state electricity distribution companies continue to be in a financial mess. And these fellows would rather not buy electricity than buy electricity at a price that causes them to have increased their losses. This is how perverse they are. Right? Because for them, politically, it's worse to have existing consumers pay a higher tariff than to deny millions of customers electricity at all. On the other end of the extreme, you have Coal India, that is quite impervious to its contractual obligations. So what happens? You have a whole bunch of bids. You know, we have out of 200 or 300,000 megawatts of capacity, 250 already installed, 50,000 in construction. 100,000 megawatts is today distressed or close to distress. 100,000 megawatts. That's 5 lakh crores worth of investments, 3.5 lakh crores worth of debt. Of which 3 lakh crores comfortably, or 2.8 if you want to split hairs, sits with public sector banks. Of this 1 lakh megawatts of capacity, about, I'm forgetting the number now, but about 20,000 megawatts to be precise, is with projects that have had their captive coal mines stripped away by the Supreme Court. That's 1/5, right? Then there's another 33,000 megawatts in coal linkage dependent projects, where Coal India has not been able to meet its obligations to deliver the coal that it had promised. So what have these fellows done now? They don't get the coal, so some of them have gone back to the state governments and said, can we import coal so that we can operate at a minimum PLF? State government says, okay, go ahead. So they go and import coal. But the imported coal is at a higher price. So they go to the state electricity regulator and say, can we now have fuel to the extent of the shortfall as a pass-through? Because it's not my fault that I didn't have the coal. State electricity regulator says, you had a contract, you bid a certain price, you stay at that price, I'm not allowing you. Fellow's response is, but it's not my fault. It's the government's fault. State government's reply is, it's not the state government's fault, please go to the central government. Everybody is in litigation, nobody's taking any decisions. Okay. So this, I'm just giving you, and you can replicate this story, it goes on and on. Now, the knock-on effects of this is that there are project delays that have happened. As a result of the project delays, interest during construction is accumulating. Instead, interest during construction accumulates, it increases project cost by 10% a year. That you have a delay for 3 years, the capital structure of the project is finished. The fellow doesn't have the equity, the bank is left holding nothing. So what it requires now is for all these people to come together, the bankers, state governments, the state electricity regulators, the Central Electricity Regulatory Commission, the Ministry of Coal, the Ministry of Power, the Ministry of Finance, the RBI, to come up with some negotiated settlements. This is where leadership is very important. Because if you go by the primacy of contracts alone as a philosophy for solving this problem, nothing's going to get done. So it requires out-of-court settlements between strong leaders who are willing to take risks. The Gujarat government has very pragmatically solved some of its problems. I'm expecting that over the next, so this is not easy, so this will take time to resolve, but I'm expecting that over the next 6, 8, whatever, 12 months, that there will be negotiated settlements that will start emerging, that will solve some of the problems. I don't want to go into too much more detail, but only to leave you the thought that out of the 1 lakh crore of compromise capacity, I believe that 50 to 60,000 megawatts can be salvaged. There will, however, be 30, 40,000 megawatts of capacity that will continue to languish, and that will represent a drag on the banking system. So that brings me to the last leg of my comments very quickly on the banking system. So the banking system, as you all know, you know, 2/3 of it is still in the public sector. And if you look at the public sector banks, I think their total loans are about 46 lakh crores. 11.6% of those 46 lakh crores are stressed. Of that 11.6%, 7.2% are restructured assets. 4.4% are NPAs. And this total number of stressed assets come to something like 6 lakh crores or something. And against that 6 lakh crores, they have made cumulative provisions so far of about 1.2 lakh crores. Now, unless proactive measures are taken to solve the kinds of problems I was just describing in the power sector, my sense is that not only is the percentage of restructured assets going to rise, but the share of restructured assets that is going to become NPAs is also going to rise. So to cut a long story short, the capital requirements just to fix the asset quality of the banks is actually quite large. It's hidden and it's latent right now, but it is quite large. Now on top of that, by 2018, India needs to be Basel III compliant. The Ministry of Finance itself estimates that quite apart from additional provisions that may or may not be required, just to be Basel III compliant and deliver reasonable credit growth in the interim, the banks will need to raise an additional capital of about 2.2, 2.3 lakh crores. Right? Now, if you add what I've described as potential capital losses from unsalvageable infrastructure assets, my guesstimate is that over the next 4 years or so, public sector banks will need about 3 lakh crores of capital. Now the total market cap of public sector banks is 4 lakh crores or thereabouts. So if you have to raise, and they're trading at one time book, right? So if at today's valuation, they had to raise this 3 lakh crores, government ownership in public sector banks, which today stands on average at 62%, will have to come way below 50%. That's where I really fault this government. They haven't yet thought through what all of this means for government ownership in banks. And this is a very important agenda that they need to address, but they haven't fully got their arms around it, they haven't thought about it, and that makes me worried. Because if we do not address this problem, then what will happen is that the financial system will generally be credit constrained and will make credit support for what looks like a burgeoning economic recovery very difficult. So the recapitalization of banks and its implications for government ownership is a big reform agenda that I would really like this government to focus on. They haven't, as a citizen of this country, I'd really like them to focus on it, and haven't done that. But as IDFC in conclusion, I'd be very happy if they didn't focus on it. Because what it means is that as IDFC becomes a bank, you will have all day to take away market share. So I will, and that's all, that's really all I had to say. Thank you for being patient with my comments. I'm very happy to take any questions if there are any from the floor. Please introduce yourself. And
I'm Anurag Jain from Canara HSBC Life Insurance. Just if you can touch upon your views on IDFC as a bank.
Yeah. So as I said, the fact that public sector banks, at least if my analysis is halfway correct, my analysis can turn out to be incorrect, and I'll tell you under what circumstances it can turn out to be incorrect, is that if interest rates drop sharply, that could change things around quite dramatically for the banks, because their bond portfolios will suddenly become very valuable, and they will be able to monetize. I expect, if I were in the RBI, I would be recommending that they be allowed then to monetize those profits and recapitalize themselves, and that would be a very important boost to the balance sheets of public sector banks. But we don't know if that's going to happen. If it does, it'll be terrific. If it doesn't, it'll also be terrific, because it will mean that the competition that public sector banks will be able to bring over the next several years will be muted, and that will be a big opportunity for IDFC Bank. But IDFC Bank has the very fundamental advantage that it can now learn from the mistakes of others and take advantage of technologies that banks that came into being 10 years ago could not. So if I were to describe one differentiating feature of the emerging IDFC Bank, it would really be the use of technology to be able to drive two things. One is a very different customer experience than what other banks have been able to do. And then on the operating side, cost to income ratios that should be significantly lower than the best in class of existing banks. That's how I see IDFC Bank's strategic advantage. Any other questions? Yes.
Sir, this is Chetan Shah from Jeet Capital. Just take your last point forward in terms of money which is required by the banking system and the capital which is needed. If I take it forward in terms of the Make in India project of Government of India, in terms of manufacturing investment which this country will be needed going forward, if financial system per se is not strong enough. One point is that. Second point is in terms of in a global competitive scenario, when you have so many FTAs which has been signed, how do you foresee that this anomaly of somebody can import in India which is far cheaper than actually incentivize domestic corporates to put their money in this country in a still uncertain environment where there is still not a lot of clarity of certain things except two or three big reforms which we are talking about, which is either a land acquisition, labor reform or GST. Beyond that, there are a lot of small things which is a day-to-day need of this running the business over a bit of next 10 to 20 years. So what's your thought on that?
So the thought on that is that for India to become a globally competitive economy for manufacturing, for large scale manufacturing, I think will take quite a bit of time. So not that it can't be done, I think that India's growth, whatever it will be, I personally disagree with those who argue that there's an opportunity to replicate what China did 20 years ago. The world has changed very fundamentally, and I don't think that we will be able to do an export-led manufacturing growth story in India at nearly the same scale as what the Chinese were able to deliver. I see the Indian growth story much more propelled by domestic consumption. And so it's the things that we are familiar with that actually have to do with the purchasing power, the growing purchasing power of and willingness to purchase of the domestic emerging middle class, complemented with the rapidly growing urbanization. Those two phenomena are going to drive really India's growth pattern. In manufacturing, I see us developing a niche which could become in value-added terms quite significant, although in job creation terms not so significant, in higher-end engineering-intensive manufacturing. So whether it is taking the auto supply chain to the next, yesterday I spent some time with people from United Technologies. United Technologies now have 6,000 employees in this country. And they are very large in elevators manufacturing, but they're also very big in aerospace. And in Bangalore, they employ something like 4,000, 5,000 people doing all kinds of stuff for helicopters in a global supply chain. And they take advantage of relatively well-educated, engineers, et cetera, et cetera. They're not really here to take advantage of low-cost labor to do mass cheap manufacturing. I don't know if that answers your question. In a nutshell, what I'm trying to say is that ours cannot be, at least in my personal opinion, an export-led manufacturing growth story. Our niche in manufacturing will probably at the higher end, that will be engineering intensive. I believe that our growth, however, will be propelled by domestic factors, particularly domestic consumption.
Sir, I just take it forward. If I understand it correctly, can this happen this way that some of the consumption sectors, like say electronics is one of the electronics, like mobile phones and stuff like that. India is a third largest import item in our list after crude and gold, but there is absolutely no clarity on that. Recently we have seen Nokia's Chennai plant shut down for whatever reason for that. So can government of India focus or forces some of these MNCs which are importing this product for India as a consumption market and help them or facilitate them to set up their own manufacturing or assembly plants in India and give them some incentives in a timeline fashion to fast track this entire process of Make in India where domestic corporates or companies are still grappling with availability of fund or no clarity on things. Is it possible?
It is possible, but so in higher end electronics I can see that happening, but I can't see it happening in low end textiles. All I'm saying. Any other questions? Okay, if not, then I will leave you to enjoy the rest of the afternoon. Thank you very much. So, I have an announcement to make which is going to be a disappointing one. And I suspect that a lot of you are gathered here not to listen to me, but to listen to Mr. Suresh Prabhu. And Mr. Suresh Prabhu, the invitation was actually accepted by Mr. Prabhu before he got anointed as minister. So we just heard this morning that he will unfortunately not be able to join us this evening. But we are trying very hard for him to join us by video link tomorrow. So I apologize deeply on his behalf. He's asked me to convey to you his disappointment not being able to hear, to be here. We are obviously very disappointed that he could not come. But I don't want to begrudge the matter, because I'd rather have him fixing our railways than coming here to enlarge IDFC and our clients. So, but I'm still optimistic that we'll be able to get him by video link tomorrow morning. So please bear with us.